Isn't it funny how when you're a kid, like they used to say, oh, you throw like a girl. It used to offend me immensely. You know, you get out there and you hear people, oh, you throw like a girl, or I'll throw with my right hand, which is quite good, and it'll go really far, and then I'll throw with my left hand, and I'm like, oh, my left arm's like a girl.
Yes.
And then you kind of think, did I just say that?
I told a guy in my boxing fitness class the other day that he punched like a girl,
and really?
He didn't seem to mind that too much, but... one of my favourite stories about punching like a girl is about Lucia Riker, who's a world champion boxer. And the Discovery Channel did a test between her and a man in the same weight class, an Olympic boxer, to see who punched harder.
Right.
And she punched like something like 200 pounds harder than he did.
Oh, wow.
When she hit the dummy, the back of the dummy's head flew off. And then she said afterwards... I don't punch like a girl or a man. I punch like a coordinated athlete.
Yeah.
And that's really, you know, the best anyone could hope for. And if you just happen to be a girl, well, you know, good luck to you.
Yeah, I don't mind throwing like a girl.
You were telling me how when you reached the age of 8, you weren't allowed to play soccer anymore for the club that you played with.
Yeah, I went down to the club and I just thought, oh, my brothers are playing, so why not give it a go? And I ended up playing for a season with all the boys. I was the only girl in the club, and you know, a season later they kind of just thought, oh, she's getting a bit older and we shouldn't really let her play anymore, she might get hurt, so they banned me from playing.
Did you think you'd get hurt?
No, I was tearing shreds off them.
Right.
I was actually probably too good. It's always the mothers that had a problem with me
really
beating the boys. Yeah, it was funny.
Yeah.
No, can't do that to my son.
Because I remember when I started, I hadn't even started boxing, but it was boxer size, like a boxing fitness.
Yeah.
And the old trainer said, oh, women can't fight, you know, it's because of they've got breasts. and I said, right. I thought, that doesn't sound right, but
yeah.
I didn't want to sort of, you know.
That doesn't sound right.
I didn't really want to fight then.
I wouldn't have thought breasts would hold you back that much.
When you play sport, if you're a woman, you risk sort of that. Those accusations of being like a man or mannish or unfeminine or whatever.
Yeah.
And that's like that's a double deterrent, you know. If scaring you about losing your reproductive capacities doesn't work, then we'll try and scare you by making you think that you're going to turn yourself into a man and sort of completely sort of lose your femininity. And so the Matildas were famous for the calendar sort of era where they pose. Was it naked? It was
yes,
naked.
Yes, it was naked calendar. Yeah.
Were you in that calendar?
I was 16 at the time, so,
okay.
So no. I was
below
far.
The age of
yeah.
calendar. Did it help,
people.
Do you think, or was it just...
It did its purpose. It got the name out there, and it wasn't in the Football Federation. It wasn't... We weren't together with the men. It was on its own, and they were struggling for money, so all of those things come into
So it helped
account.
With it? Push
it
them ahead
It helped
bit.
Get the name... The Matildas out there.
Yeah.
Because at that point you're like, oh, what's the female, you know, football team called? And they're like, I don't know, oh, didn't they do that calendar? Oh yeah, the Matildas.
Yes,
so it served its purpose at that point in time.
Yeah.
But now we're letting our football, you know, make the front page, not how we're dressed or what we look like.
I went to the Women's World Championships in Barbados last year, which is Women's World Boxing Championships, because women are going to be included in the Olympics in 2012,
yeah.
for the first time ever. And so this was like the first World Championship since that announcement, so I really wanted to see what the standard was like. And it was really high, it was incredible. In fact, a lot of the time I just kind of forgot that I was watching other female boxers, and it was like, this is just the beginning, and the men should be very afraid about what's coming, because...
Yeah.
You know, it's very hard to distinguish them. But it seems like that IEBA, which is the International Boxing Association, was a bit worried about that. So for the actual finals, they didn't make them, but they pressured a lot of the competitors to wear skirts. They redesigned this uniform, or, you know, two different types of uniform. One was like a sort of little, like a cheerleader's skirt, and some of them wore these skirts, some of them just didn't. And then the other one was like a little tight, little like a skort, like a tennis skirt.
That'd be kind of like a compliment in a way, because they're so good at boxing.
That something has
that
to...
Something has to be to verify that, you know, who
they
are.
That they're not watching boys.
They're not watching boys, but then again, why should you? Can't it just be the player in... the boxer in the red shorts playing against the boxer in the black shorts?
Yeah. It was quite controversial, I remember. There was, like, people, you know, really angry about it, especially sort of, you know, officials in individual international teams and coaches and things were really angry about it because it was sort of demeaning. I mean, the judges in boxing are sitting ringside looking up, so it's like they're not looking down like they are in tennis. They're looking up a skirt.
Well, they had basketball in the tight uniforms trying to make it more appealing,
yes.
But the basketballers hated it. So now we're back to shorts and singlets for them.
Okay.
And they tried to get us to, the Matildas, to wear the skin tight uniform.
Ah.
And we said, no, we had to put forward all these reasons why.
I mean, I think that sort of sex sells idea sort of applies just as much to the men these days as it does to women in a way, because they're
sort of... Of course, because there's not eye candy out there.
Yes.
You know, a lot of people might not go.
I think, as you were saying, that the, you know, there are people watching on all different levels and getting all sorts of different things out of watching athletes at play. And if men like to watch women athletes because they're hot, it's better that they're watching athletes than expecting women just to be sort of passive and decorative and pole dancers or strippers or something else, you know, like at least they're doing something that's giving them some satisfaction as athletes, and the men are watching, you know, for whatever reason they want to watch, but as long as they're watching, that's a good thing.
Yeah, and I think you know, for every hot athlete that they're watching, there's like 20 other athletes that are being watched at the same time, so why not? Like, if whether they're hot or not, if one person brings a spectator in, we all benefit, so.
I was saying before that it's not so hard for individual female athletes to get a lot of media coverage and exposure because they kind of stand alone as a kind of odd one out. But if it's a whole team, like a whole team of soccer players and international teams of female soccer players, it's much more of a threat to this idea of kind of masculine supremacy on the sporting field. And because you'd probably whoop most guys, you know, like just sort of average Joes who might play a bit of weekend soccer. I mean, they just wouldn't have a chance against the Matildas or...
Yeah, no, you know. Well, you kind of get the feeling that everyone wants to support you, but there's not really that mainstream support, not that commercial support, so it makes it hard as an elite athlete to make ends meet. And that's why you see a lot of females actually stop playing sport because of that, okay, well, I can either go get a job and get a career and have money and be quite comfortable, or I can continue to try and excel in this sport and train and, you know, just make ends meet. If I don't have a partner, if I don't have a support network, I might not make it. So, you know.
It's like being an artist, you know, just you do it because you love it.
Yeah.
Not because
it makes
got
you
any
money.
Career path. Yeah.
You could say, I wear the number one shirt for the Matildas. Mark Schwarzer wears the number one shirt for the Socceroos.
Mm-hmm.
And when you try and see us in the same light, you can't. He earns more money. He brings more people to games. He just can't compete.
Do you think if it's like a chicken and egg situation, that if you had the prime time exposure, then you could get more sponsorship dollars, you could get more viewers, that you would be given at least half a chance to win people over, to convince them that your game is worth watching, is this entertaining?
Yeah, well, the World Cup alone shows that, you know, when people are sitting up at 2 o'clock in the morning watching you play and then saying, oh, how fantastic it was, and the level of skill and the level of, you know, technical ability, it was just amazing to watch. That small group of people, if they could just go tell other people, it's word of mouth, you get more people to games, more people, so that we're taken on our own merit, not, compared to the men's match I just watched, they weren't as strong, they weren't as dominant, they didn't jump as high, they didn't run as fast.
Mm.
But if they looked at it in our own light, we actually have to think more, we have to be technically good. We have awards at the moment, you know, female footballer of the year.
Yeah.
But the men's equivalent is not called male footballer of the year.
Yes.
They're called footballer of the year.
Yes.
I hope, you know, the stigma of you have to attach, you know, the Matildas, Australia's female football team. Well, you wouldn't think a male team would be called Matildas. Why do you have to latch?
Yes.
Why can't
I like
we just
it when
be
people
footballers?
Introduce me. They might do it to you too, as a female soccer player or a female boxer. And I go, thank God you mentioned female because, you know, otherwise people might not know.
Exactly.
Yeah. Like,
women are just making up so much of the population who are playing. There's not enough fields to cover us.
Right.
So we're going hell for leather.
Yeah. So all those women playing are going to be wanting to watch elite level soccer played by women, I would imagine. I'm always hungry to watch a high level women's boxing bout, you know, wherever I can get my hands on it. And, you know, you're role models too for, little replicas of yourself, you know, 10 years, 15 years later, who are watching you now and know that they can't be told by some club that they can't play anymore.
Because they're a girl, yeah.
Yeah.